It is not the profession of a nuclear scientist to tell stories, nor to do TED Talks. Yet I ventured into the uncharted region because I have a story to tell. The story of a people's science movement that swept a revolution in this country. Let's look at this picture. You find Karl Marx and his famous Das Kapital. Ever since he published his magnum opus, Das Kapital, we have been hearing the concept of capital in several other variant mutant forms. We have the intellectual capital, we have the knowledge capital, the social capital, the cultural capital, venture capital, monetary capital, and now we have the newfangled paradigm, science capital. What is the science capital? Science capital is a paradigm evolved at the King's College London about 5 years ago, but practiced by the Keralites 55 years ago. It was articulated and phraseologized into that concept only very, very recently. Now, science capital to us is like a hold all or a bag, school bag, in which we put all our, in that backpack, we put all our sciencey stuff together. What we know about science, how we think about science, who we know in science, and all those small little microscopic interactions which we have in our daily life with respect to science events. Whether it is a dust particle in your breathing zone, or whether it is an insecticide which is sticking to the peel of your banana, these are all events where science has made an impact in this. By building a science capital, what impact will it have on the body social or on the body societal? That is a question which I am trying to explore. To that, I would like you to take to my hometown, the small place, Kerala. It looks like a Kerala, a bitter gourd, but it has a lot of bitter experience and lessons to learn and to teach. So a creative experiment to transform and transmute the society into a better one, that creative experiment was conducted in this part of the land, that is the Kerala portion of it. How did we do it? That's the question. This is a nuclear reactor at Trombay 55 years ago. I was working in this reactor 55 years ago. And I was in charge of the safety of the reactor. Of all the places in the world, the safest place is a nuclear reactor. So the safety officer has nothing to do. He has to take the passage of time back and forth running through. I was in the third shift. And the third shift is from 11 to 7 or 11 to 8 in the morning. What do I do? To keep myself awake, to keep me free from the slumber and sleep that might attack me, I used to take a notebook in which I used to jot down 10 English technical terms. Sitting there, making a time travel back in time, scratching my head into my romantic school days, I used to convert those 20 English words into my mother tongue, Malayalam. That is the science capital. I used to produce 20 words in my language sitting there. This work is for 30 days. So I produced 600 words on my own, and my friends also did the same thing. Now the question is, why did we make these words? Why did we make this science capital? We had a mentor whom we affectionately called Dr. M.P. He had been a nuclear engineer. He had been to Soviet Union. He fell in love with the Russian language. He fell in love with the Russian language, the scientific popularization work. There was a revolution which Russia conducted. He came back to India and told us, let 100 flowers bloom. And 100 scientists, like electrons, around the nucleus, we went up to him. That was a nuclear attraction of the Soviet Revolution, which Dr. M.P. brought to this. So we made words. All these words were exported to our hometown. The pundits looked it under the microscope and put it into severe linguistic dissection. They accepted, changed certain things, but a vocabulary, an inventory of vocabulary was built based on this. So from those words, we made syntaxes, we made sentences. Those sentences became paragraphs, short notes. From paragraphs, we went into articles. And from articles, we went into journals. And from journals, we went into book form. In short, a genre of literature called creative science literature was brought into my language. And when this was happening, it was also happening in other languages too. But we were the vanguard as the front runner of this. Here you will find the classical example. We have a magazine for children under the age 14, exclusively dealing with science. And 50,000 copies are being sold every month to individual subscribers and not through newsstands. So we expect a readership of 10 with teachers and parents involved. So that's the magnitude and the dimension of creative science literature we could bring into this language with Eureka. With the production of Eureka, we have been extremely comfortable with the literature aspect of it. Now we thought literacy is one, science numeracy is one, but how do we reach out to the people? How to convert it into a people's science moment? That was a grand challenge which we had to face. So we designed a strategy. Our strategy is go through the kitchen, go through the back door, not through the front door. We went into the kitchen, and a Kerala kitchen in those times, or in my grandmother's time, was abominable in every sense. I remember my grandmother struggling in the wet season with wet twigs not being able to sustain a flame and generating smoke, and you will find tears running down her cheeks soaked in smoke. How to design a smokeless fireplace? That was a challenge the people's science movement of my state took up first. That's a typical fireplace you are seeing this. We looked at the heat transfer efficiency of this. We also looked at the fire burning capacity, and we designed a particular format which you are finding over here. And 500,000 chulas or fireplaces were sold out. The moment these were sold out, we have made a conquest of the Kerala kitchen. Next time when we go, we were welcome because the chulas were working well and there were no lacrimatory instances in the kitchen. From this, we took the next tottering step forward. That is, we just bought out a 20-page booklet. That booklet will help these women when they go to the primary health center to ask the doctor whether he has prescribed any of the drugs prescribed by World Health Organization, and that book was given to them. There were 150 drugs which were being lavishly prescribed by doctors in my home state, which were against the WHO's recommended guidelines. Every woman will take and ask her doctor, have you prescribed anything from this book? So doctors have to educate or re-educate or re-engineering their education so that they could comply with the requirement of a public science movement. So having accomplished this, we went out of the state. Then the All India People Science Movement emerged. There were Federation of Indian Language Science Associations. There was a convergence of public spirit on this subject. At that time, that was 1984, night, second night, third morning, Bhopal. The worst industrial disaster has happened. Methyl isocyanide, one of the ingredients of the insecticide, escaped, either by accident or by design, that is yet to be deciphered. And in the first week, 8,000 people perished. And in the month that followed, another 8,000 perished. This is the greatest tragedy of industrial disaster in this country. We are angry, naturally and legitimately. But how do you give expression in a meaningful manner to your anger? Moral indignation is one thing, but practical field, you find an entirely different response. So we decided we shall not buy everyday batteries in the state of Kerala. Union Carbide makes everyday batteries, and that is one of their large revenue-earning commodities, to which we put a stiff resistance, and we refuse to buy this. It may not have made a monetary impact on an industrial giant, but it was surely a learned response, and no other response could be made to that company. Rest is a legal story. I am not going into that. But public frustration and indignation was shown this. So from the fireplace to Bhopal tragedy and back to Kerala. Here you find Hindustan Coca-Cola's bottling plant, 5 kilometers from my house in Palghat. This is where the war on water was fought. Hindustan Coca-Cola bought 20 hectares of farmland in my village. They got permission to drill 6 boreholes. And with that 6 boreholes, their daily requirement of water, groundwater, it was 1.5 liters per day. To make 1 liter of Coca-Cola, you need 4 liters of fresh water. That's the industrial ratio. 1 liter of Coke needs 4 liters of fresh water. In that farmland, in that village, there were inhabitants of 3,000, out of which 2,000 were farmers. The company bought the services of 400 workers and made it part of their industrial consignment. The village was originally happy. One of the byproducts, a sludge product which is coming out of the process, was given as free gift to the farmers. So they could use it as a fertilizer. Doubly happy. That was a honeymoon halcyon times. Thereafter, after 3 years, we found that the groundwater was shrinking. Water levels went down. And we also found from the sludge, cadmium has escaped into the rice fields. Rice has got that remarkable capability to absorb cadmium from water. This is exactly what happened in Japan, and which is known as Itai-Itai disease. That was manifested in the villages of Kerala at Plachimada. Now look at how the science capital was brought to play. It was brought to critical size so that a chain reaction takes place. Professors, teachers, lawyers, and all the professionals started building a science capital around this. Within a year, we were able to do that. There was also a legal fight going along. And there is a public resistance. You can see the mass movement which is happening in front of that gate. It went up to the Supreme Court. And then came a historic judgment that water is not a private property or a private commodity. This is an extremely important judgment, and they also went to the corollary of that, that water is a public property. This is called the Plachimada Declaration, and it was the people's science movement which brought it to this culmination of the declaration of the Plachimada Declaration of Water. Now we come to a beautiful, romantic place in Kerala, which is called the Silent Valley. This is about 90 square kilometers of core forest with about 150 square kilometers of a buffer zone. Now, there was a development versus biodiversity preservation conflict. When you have a large body of water and it's a pristine purity, the industrial lobby thought, let us have a hydroelectric project over here. And the marketing started. A hydroelectric project will give you electricity. Electricity correlates well with your standard of living. So if you want a good quality of life, you please allow electricity to be produced. The natural and probable consequence of production of electricity is this. A large amount of land will undergo under inundation and many of the trees will be perishing. The biodiversity will be declining, decaying and get damaged. This we also brought into a very, very classical conquest. People asked, this is the conflict between man and monkey. Do you want the monkey to be preserved or do you want the man to be preserved? That was the question. What you are seeing now is the lion-tailed monkey, which is a rare species in the Silent Valley. Are we going for the flora and fauna or are we going for human development? This was the first conflict we had between developmentalists on one side and environmentalists on the other side. A critical mass was created by us. Public awareness programs were run. Massive educational campaign all through the colleges, schools and public streets everywhere. And it went up to the Prime Minister. Ms. Gandhi was at that time at the helm of affairs. Professor M.G.K. Menon, one of the outstanding nuclear scientists of this country, was a scientific advisor. And he told, it is the monkey which should prevail and not the man at this time. The monkey cannot be rehabilitated, but man can be rehabilitated. That was a classic instance he gave. And we succeeded in preserving a place of pristine purity in the Western Ghats, today known as a national park, thanks to the science capital built by a people's science movement. Coming back to the last slide, Here you will find the structure of the hydrogen atom. A proton in the nucleus and an electron revolving around it. Today, the people's science movement is a macromolecule with a large number of millions of carbon atoms combined in a very, very synergetic way, in a very, very coherent way, with respect to the framework of the people's science movement. I was a hydrogen atom. The smallest possible atom in the world is a hydrogen atom. So I feel proud, legitimately proud of the fact that I was a small atom in this big molecule. Thank you.